저녁 찬양 예배, we're gonna do 특순 special praise. So let's sing this song together, get used to it, and glorify the Lord.
Oh,
Thank you.
Now to lead us in prayer will be 이순희 권사님.
Our loving Father, God of amazing grace and love, we give you honor, thanksgiving, and all the praise and glory due to your worthy name with one accord. Thank you for bringing each one of us into your holy presence through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. In our AM English worship service, we confess our sins and hardened hearts to our neighbors for whom you have spilled your precious blood on the cross of Calvary. We know we are helpless and hopeless, full of guilt, finding no way to life of real purpose until we meet you face to face, face to face in your love. We shout, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to you on this Palm Sunday. We proclaim you with great joy to the whole world as our everlasting King of love and peace and true humility, asking your protection and overflowing blessings on our Myeongsang congregation and all the churches in this blessed land of Korea. Help us and strengthen us to lead a life of loving service and care for your people and kingdom, giving glory until death. We pray for Reverends Saman and Hana Kim to be blessed and bear much more fruit in the days to come, as always, as the cult wonderfully used for our Master and Lord. And we especially pray for Joseph Kim, who will deliver today's message with full of the Holy Spirit's power and wisdom to enlarge your kingdom in the global language of English. Amen. We humbly commit our problems through which Satan tries to tear us down. I'm sure they will be solved beautifully at your words, peace be still, in your right time and in your blessed will. I pray in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes to us from the Gospel of Mark, Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. And helping us with the reading today will be Kwon Sunmin 집사님 and Im Hanna 집사님.
As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples,
saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here.
If anyone asks you, why are you doing this? Say, the Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.
They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at the doorway as they untied it.
Some people standing there asked, what are you doing untying the colt?
They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go.
When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it.
Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread the branches they had cut in the fields.
Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed is the coming kingdom of our Father David.
Hosanna in the highest heaven.
Amen.
Amen. Now for our announcements, welcome everyone to our English worship service, Awake Ministries here at Myeongsang Church. If we have any newcomers in the room today, please come forward at the end of our service so that we can say hello and give you a small present. And also, please continue praying for our membership goal that we've set, that we've been discussing. Keep it in your prayers, keep it in your thoughts. Tell people about this beautiful service that we have here. And also, please hold our Cambodia missions team in your prayers. We've been listing the names here in the bulletin for the past several months, actually. So please keep them in your prayers. And also, they do need your support. They are requesting donations of lightly used school supplies. So, lightly used, 깨끗하게 쓴 학용품. So, if you consider it garbage, you know, doesn't mean you just bring it here. But if it's something truly that can still be used, that still has value, the children there, it's not even a matter of money. It's difficult to even purchase things there, even if we had the money. But if God does move your heart, if you don't really have anything at home, school supplies, things like that, you can support us with small financial gifts. And I want to emphasize small. I don't want to, you know, anyone to feel pressured to give. As soon as we announced this in our internal leadership chat room, one of our officers gave 50,000 won. And he said, oh, it's so small. But actually, that was a very large donation because we have a lot of people, right? So if we all give a little bit, that can add up to a lot. We don't need a couple of people to give, you know, 50 or 500,000. We need a lot of people to give 5,000, 10,000 won. And I think that we can raise the money this way. So I hope that God moves your hearts. So please keep that in mind. Look around at home and see if you have anything that can be worth giving, or if not, please consider supporting us financially. You can speak to Yunyeon Chipsanim or Chungmunim if you are interested for further details. Also, we have a special visitor, not really a visitor because he's coming back, but we have Moon Gwanyoung Chipsanim in the audience with us today. He's coming to us from Ghana, where he was in the missions field. Could you stand up for one moment? Could we give him a round of applause? So he's spent time in Ghana, where he recently finished constructing a church there. So God has blessed him greatly. He'll be in Korea for the time being. So while he's here, it's great to have him back, and also his wife with us. So please, afterwards, after the service, please go over and greet him as well. Also, our 20th anniversary service, as we've been mentioning, we'll be holding it on April 28th at the end of this month, the last Sunday of this month. So please keep that in your prayers. There's a lot of preparation going into this. And we'll also be having the special praise that evening in the main evening service. We sang the song today, He is Jehovah, right? I love this song, it's a lot of energy. He is Jehovah, right? And don't worry, the lyrics are a little complicated, but we made a version where we're mixing the Korean and the English. So basically, He is Jehovah will be all in English, and then all the hard parts will be in Korean. So it'll be easy for everyone to sing along. So please keep that in your prayers. And also, you might have noticed, we've been waiting a while, but we created our new church, our new service logo for Awake Ministries. So you'll be seeing that a lot in the coming days, right? If you're curious what that is exactly, that's our new logo. And there's a lot of meaning behind it. You know, we're an English worship that is awake, that awakens others, that awakens the dawn, as we've been saying. And we wanted something that held the church identity, right? Myeongseong church identity, right? So actually there is, in there, you see the two arches that form the M, the blue arches, is a very familiar sight to us. It doesn't have the crosses, but that is the Sang Shikjaga, right? The double crosses, the arch of our old sanctuary. And then the red, the A, is the single cross of our new sanctuary. So there's a lot of meaning in there, right? And a lot of work went into this. If you see Choi In-chul Jipsanim from the design department, tell him thank you. I made sure to buy him a big box of Krispy Kreme donuts for his work on our logo. So just if you see him, please let him know how much you appreciate it. Also, our church is celebrating communion today. So if you have not already partaken, the fifth service will be your last chance to do communion, to take part, celebrate the Lord's Supper. So please do not miss out on that. And now our Shoshana choir will be blessing us with the song Via Dolorosa.
Thank you.
here at Yeongsung Church. Let us give thanks to the God who justifies us freely through grace. I want to give thanks to all of those who serve here in AM Awake Ministries, especially to Isuni Kwonsanim for leading us in prayer today, to Kwonsunmin Jipsanim and Imhanna Jipsanim for reading from the scripture, which we always keep on our lips. And thank you to the Tehillah worship team for reminding us that it is only when we see God that we find strength to face the day. And thank you, finally, to Shoshana Choir for reminding us of the way of suffering, the Via Dolorosa, that Jesus walked upon when he laid down his life for our sins. I think this past week I heard that song, Via Dolorosa, 5 times. Right, last Sunday night, Wednesday night, today morning, I think, and you know, over and over and over again. And I've been listening to the song on YouTube this past week, because that's what pastors, you know, look at on YouTube. But every time, no matter how many times I hear it, it just hits me, you know, in the feels, right in the heart. God just moves so powerfully. And when we think about what Jesus has done for us, but we'll get to that, because that's for next Sunday, right? Today is Palm Sunday. Today is Palm Sunday. Easter's around the corner. It seems like it came so soon. But today, we read a familiar passage. It's a passage that we've probably read many, many times before on many Palm Sundays in years past. It's a very familiar image to us. Jesus riding a donkey. For those of you that have been going to church since childhood, you'll know that in Sunday school, they always have this image of Jesus riding a donkey, the palm leaves, right? The people gathered around yelling Hosanna. It's so familiar to us. It's ingrained in our minds. Jesus entering into Jerusalem, flanked by his disciples, the people shouting his name. They want to catch a glimpse of Jesus. Who is this man? Jesus, this superhero, the Messiah, the one who had come to save them. They thought that he would be their savior, their Messiah. A Messiah that would come in political power, in military strength, that would undo the force of Rome. Because Israel was living under Rome at that time. Rome ruled over Israel, much like Japan used to rule over Korea. We're very familiar with how the Israelites must have felt at that moment. The Israelite people longed to be free. They wanted to have their independence, to be a free nation once again. And all their hopes lay upon Jesus, this one man, Jesus, that was entering into their city. Finally, their deliverance had come. Finally, their moment in the sun had come. And so they came out and they crowd the streets yelling, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest heaven. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes to establish the kingdom of our father David. Blessed is he. The coming kingdom. See, that's who they were really cheering for. Not for Jesus, but for the coming kingdom. They were cheering for the person who would come in the image of their father David, because David to them represented the highest point in Israelite history when they were at their most powerful. That's who they were cheering for. The coming kingdom where Jesus would rule as a new Caesar, where Jesus would be the new emperor over the entire world. The Israelites hoped for the day when all the neighbors, all the nations who had ever interfered in Israel, who had ever come and bothered them, who had ever mistreated them, when they would be forced to come and pay homage, when they would be forced to come and bow the knee, to bow down before their King Jesus. They were waiting for it. They could not wait. It would be sweet revenge for them, for all of the suffering that they had endured over the many generations. So the people were overjoyed. They were cheering for this coming king that they thought was entering the city. And they threw their own cloaks on the ground in front of Jesus. Others, it says, spread freshly cut branches. And this event is known as the triumphal entry. That's what we call it as Christians. We call it the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. But this does not happen in a vacuum. It's not happening by itself. We have to compare it to the historical setting that Jesus was living in at that time. Because Jesus did not invent the triumphal entry. You have to understand that. He did not invent the triumphal entry. This was not a new thing that he was doing. Because the triumph was already a well-established tradition in the Roman world. Anybody in the Roman world already knew what a triumph was. It was a military parade. And this military parade was reserved only for a general returning victorious from a foreign operation, a foreign expedition. If they won and came back with all the spoils of war, then they threw this triumph to welcome him home. And what they would do is they would create this long procession, a long parade of people. And a festival would go on for days and even weeks to celebrate the general's victory. And in this procession, in this parade, this train of people, in the front you would have captured slaves, captured leaders of the enemy, captured generals, captured soldiers. They would lead the front. And then behind them, you would have all the treasures, right? The captured weapons, valuable items, exotic animals, artwork, the plunder from the war. That's what would follow. And then after that came the general's troops. The general's troops would follow after that, and they would be singing and cheering for their general. And then finally, the general would come at the very end of this long column of people. The general would come at the very end, and he would be riding a chariot drawn by four majestic horses. He would be in a robe painted and a wreath, a crown of laurel. Every time we see a picture of Caesar, he has that crown on his head of leaves. The general would be wearing this because in that moment, during that triumph, the general stood in place of the king. He was king for a day. And historians say that the general in that moment was even seen to be next to a god, that he was a deity for just that one moment during his triumph. And the entire procession would enter into Rome, they would enter into the city, and they would make their way to the temple of Jupiter. And there the general would make sacrifices to give thanks for his successful campaign. And this would start feasts and games in his honor. And the general became a celebrity, a hero to all the Roman people. After that point, he was untouchable. That's what a triumph actually was. And the triumph did not just last for that one moment. Because you can throw a great party, but no one's going to remember that. It did not last for just that one moment because an arch would be constructed in its honor. That's what they would do in the Roman world. They would hold this triumph, this great party, but then they would build an arch. The most well-known arch in New York City is at the entrance to Washington Square Park. Very famous. If you visit New York, you definitely have to visit it. My high school was very close by in downtown Manhattan, so I would spend many afternoons at Washington Square Park. But it's not the only arch in the world, we know that, because the arch in New York City was actually modeled after another arch. The most famous arch in the modern world is the Arc de Triomphe in Paris. We all know that famous arch in Paris, France. And this French arch also served as the inspiration to Seojaepil when he designed 독립문, the Independence Gate here in Seoul. He was inspired by the French arch. He saw a picture of it and drew a sketch, a design, and gave it to the construction firm. But both the arches in New York and here in Seoul are a copy of the French one, but they are copies of a copy. Because the French arch was modeled after the Arch of Titus. The Arch of Titus was built to commemorate the victory of Titus over Jerusalem in the year 70 AD. So this is less than 40 years after Jesus died. You know, if we're talking about something that happened 2,000 years ago, 40 years is a very, very short time span. So this is basically happening the next day, almost, after Jesus died. So this is the common practice, the tradition during Jesus' time. They would hold this majestic triumph. They would have these grand parties and feasts, food, music, dancing, singing, all of this. And then they would build this majestic arch to commemorate that moment. So Jesus did not invent the triumphal entry. He did not do any of that. But what he did do is reinvent it. Because if you compare, the way he entered Jerusalem can be seen as an anti-triumph. It was an anti-triumph. Instead of all the powerful and prestigious leaders greeting him into the city, welcoming him in, it was the simple people who gathered. It was the simple people who gathered to cheer for Jesus. The leaders were secretly plotting on how to kill Jesus, how to get rid of him, because he was a prophet. This was Jesus's version of Rome's triumph. But it couldn't compare to the glory or the splendor of what Rome did. You know, they say like 2% 부족, lacking 2%. But this was like 200, 2,000% short. Jesus had no conquered prisoners going before him. He had no captured treasure, no artifacts, just his disciples that he sent to get a young donkey, it says. A young donkey, a colt, to ride in on. And this was the most glaring difference, of course, in Jesus' triumphal entry. That he was riding in on a lowly donkey instead of a majestic war horse, a chariot made of iron drawn by four horses. He was fulfilling the prophecy of Zechariah, who wrote, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey." He continues on to say, "I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations." Jesus did not enter the city as a champion of war. He came as a conqueror of peace. The people who gathered to greet him there that day shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna." And Hosanna is an expression of praise to God. But the people meant it for Jesus as a human, because that's who they thought he was. That was the entirety of who they thought Jesus was. They thought he was another human, just another guy. The disciples, of course, had already forgotten everything that Jesus told them. Jesus explained to them, as we talked about last Sunday, right? Like a mom telling their kid before they go into the party, like, "Behave, okay? Please, don't embarrass me." The disciples had already forgotten everything that Jesus told them when he said, "Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Even though Jesus took the time to try to get them to remember this truth as they entered into the city, as soon as they saw the crowds cheering, as soon as they saw the people gathered and throwing their cloaks on the road, they were swept away. They forgot what Jesus told them about humility. They got caught up in the moment. They soaked in this praise, the praise of the people, and they accepted it as their own. Because who doesn't enjoy being loved? Who doesn't enjoy being the center of attention? To have people cheering for you. But Jesus knew that's not why he was there. In spite of all this, Jesus knew that this was nothing. Even compared to the Roman triumph, this was nothing. It was just a poor imitation. But compared to the glory that waited for him in heaven, it truly, truly was nothing. Jesus knew that's not why he was there. No matter how loudly the people shouted his name, he never let it affect his purpose. He did not let it affect his mission, because he had come to Jerusalem for one purpose: to die. To die. To make himself a servant and a slave, to suffer and suffocate on the cross for our sins. So he did not let the crowd sway him. No matter how loud they shouted, he did not let the crowd sway him, because he knew it was just empty praise. In all the noise and excitement of the triumphal entry, Jesus did not lose focus on his one true calling. You know, there's a new craze going on, a new mania in health food. I don't know if you've heard about it, but honey, as we know, has always been considered very good for our health. But apparently, I found out, not all honey is the same. Everyone's getting very interested now. I'm talking about health food, right? 건강, this is well-being food. Nowadays, there's a huge demand for Manuka honey from New Zealand. I don't know if you've heard about it. Manuka honey from New Zealand. This honey is supposed to have a lot of positive health effects. And there's a lot of debate about whether it works or not. I'm not sure. But the fact is that authentic Manuka honey is actually very hard to find. And it's quite expensive. I found the government of New Zealand, actually, they test all the Manuka honey that gets exported. They run it through these tests, and it undergoes, I found out, chemical and DNA testing to make sure that it's real Manuka honey, because they're very serious about their honey. And if it does not pass, then legally it's not allowed to have this name. But even still, right, I read that it's estimated New Zealand produces about 1,700 tons a year for export of this honey. But right now in the world, there is over 10,000 tons of Manuka honey being sold. So obviously this difference, right, this fake honey is coming from somewhere. Just to give you an idea of the demand that there is. I looked, and if you want to buy the real thing, a 250-gram bottle I found will cost you about 50,000 won, woman, right? For 250 grams. That's more expensive than, you know, hanugugi. That's actually like double the price of honey. And that was actually cheap. I found another store selling the same size, apparently theirs was better, same size for 85,000 won, 85,000 won, for 250 grams. That's a small, it fits in the palm of your hand. And I wonder what makes this honey so special, what apparently gives it its special properties. And I found out it's partly due to the volcanic soil in New Zealand. That's part of it. But another reason is that there's a special behavior of these bees, the honeybees that make this Manuka honey. These bees are known as monofloral. Monofloral. Mono meaning one, floral, of course, flower. And so this means that they don't visit just any flower. They don't go to any flower for their pollen, but just one. Just one flower. These bees only go to the flowers of the Manuka tree, which gives the honey its special character and its name. And we have to wonder, can we call ourselves monofloral bees? Right, that's the question. When I read about this, I wondered, am I a monofloral bee? Am I? It's an odd question, but am I a monofloral bee? Do I keep myself to just one flower? Just one flower, just one tree, one source of true life? Or do I wander from this flower to that flower, whichever is the brightest, whichever catches my attention in that moment? I mean, we have a beautiful flower arrangement here, right? Look at all the choices. And it's like this in life. In life, we have a buffet of choices, of flowers that we can go to. And we float around from this flower, that flower, whichever one seems good to us in that moment. But I thought to myself, what am I? Am I monofloral? And I don't know about you, but I know what I want to be. I want to be a bee, a monofloral bee. Because there's only one flower for me. We are made precious when we keep ourselves focused on our one true God. Our true worth is found in focusing on the only one who is actually worthy of our love and our hope and our attention. Just as God told Joshua, as they were about to cross into the promised land, God told him, "Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Do not turn from it to the right or to the left. Keep our focus. Keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. Jesus did not turn aside to the right or to the left. In all the commotion, all the noise, and the excitement of Palm Sunday, Hosanna, entering into Jerusalem, Jesus did not lose his focus. And it's not because he did not feel the urge or the temptation, because the Bible tells us that he was tempted in every way as we are. He was tempted in every way and yet was without sin. So he was welcomed and cheered by the crowds as he entered Jerusalem on the back of this donkey. But he knew the time was coming when he would be beaten and bruised as he left the city. When he left the city, he was not on the back of the donkey, but he had a cross on his back. No matter what situation he was in, he did not change. He did not let it affect him. He did not lose focus, because he knew who God was. He knew who he was and who he was in relation to that God. If there's one thing that we can learn this Palm Sunday from our reading, from the example of Jesus, I think it is this. No matter what might come in our lives, whether it is good or bad, we must hold fast to the Lord our God. We must be willing to make ourselves monofloral, Because there is no other flower in this world for us to visit. No other flower that is worth our time, our love, and all of our hope. I hope that all of us here in Awake Ministries would continue to fix our eyes on Jesus, as it says in Hebrews, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Let us pray together.
Dear Lord, as we celebrate Palm Sunday, as we think about the good things that you have done, as we think about Jesus entering into Jerusalem, and the crowds that cheered his name, that shouted out Hosanna, we realize, Lord, that in this not so triumphal entry, how difficult it must have been, the temptation that he felt. Dear Lord, we are faced with many of these same temptations in our daily lives. We are drawn to where people pat us on the back. We are drawn only to where we are loved, to where we find warmth and happiness. But help us, Lord, to follow you no matter what may come, whether it is in the light or in the dark, whether it is in the cold or in the warmth, Lord. Let us keep our eyes fixed on you, fixed on your Son, Jesus Christ, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. We pray all of this together in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Sacrifice to you, knowing that you are a God who expands our vision and our territory beyond our wildest imaginations. Truly, you are a God of grace who deals with us not based on what we deserve, but on what you desire to lovingly give to us.
We bring before you, Lord, the first fruits of our earthly labors, and we pray that you will look with favor upon this sacrifice. We pray, Lord, that your face would shine upon us, upon our families, upon our businesses and our places of work and our places of study, and all that we do. We lift up in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, before we close our service, just a special moment, our students from Shalom will be joining us in a palm procession. Feel free to take out your phones and get photos. Come in. Together, as we conclude our service, let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you. Truly, we cry out, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Not to any earthly figure, not to any earthly king, but to you, our Heavenly Father. It is in you that we put all of our trust and hope and confidence. And we pray, Lord, now that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, who entered Jerusalem as a conqueror of peace, and the love of the Almighty Father God, who sent his Son to die for us, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, who abides in the church, be with the members of our Awake Ministries now and forever.
Amen.